This is the Skin Science Podcast. I'm Dr. Thomas Hitchcock, and here we'll investigate everything skin science and dissect it from a scientific perspective, analyze it from a medical perspective, critique it from a consumer perspective, and give insight from an industry perspective. Welcome back to the podcast. I'm Dr. Thomas Hitchcock, and this is going to be part two of the Biomecare topic. And once again, I want to welcome to the podcast Dr. Greg Laurence.
Great to be here. It wasn't that bad of a flight.
Yeah.
Thanks for inviting me back.
And thank you for wearing the exact same outfit. And of course, we have in the studio Dr. Brian Jones.
Hello, everybody. A little deja vu, but that's okay.
Yeah. And then we've got the peanut gallery in the back there. We got Dr. Jose Maldonado. I'm just learning how to say that. Is that right?
Maldonado.
There
you go. Yeah.
Okay, yeah, Maldonado. Okay, sorry. Maldonado. And then we have our lovely producers, Alan and Seti. I can't remember if Seti has the same last name as Alan. But I don't want to say your last names because I don't want people harassing you.
Yeah, it's very French sounding. Yeah. Very French sounding.
Well, anyway, so we did want to pick up where we left off last time. And we were kind of in the middle of discussing, I believe, that microbiome diversity means skin health. But before we get into that and kind of re-engage there, I want to find out from Alan and Seti, who are our resident consumers. They're not in the aesthetic or dermatology industry. What did you think about what we talked about? What was... did you get anything from that, or was there something that we should try to break down a little more? What did you think?
I understood pretty good, but any kind of extra explanation always is helpful.
Absolutely.
Since we're not doctors and there's like three doctors talking. but I understood pretty good.
Okay, well, what did you understand?
Well, I know I gotta wash my face with water only.
We didn't say anything about that. Okay, so he was sleeping back there is what he's saying. So everybody who's listening may not know, but Alan and Seti both were pivotal in bringing our series Beauty and the Bacteria to life. And so they probably are starting to nod off when they hear me talk now because they've heard me say a lot of the same stuff over and over. And so I don't blame them. Again, I should remind everybody, Angela McDonald's not here today because, again, I mean, after a month, she missed another flight. I mean, still not here. And so she'll be back tomorrow, but unfortunately, we're taping today. So,
One thing I would ask a little bit, maybe again, explanation about the probiotics, the pre and pro and
sure.
post. As well too.
Okay.
I don't think we talked about the pre.
We did not because it's, we can. Yeah, we can.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, and you've got a lot of credibility for this because I was just thinking he's a little bit like, Dr. Thomas is a little bit like Benjamin Franklin. You know, he put that kite up there with the key on it. You know, who knew what was going to happen with the electrical bolt, right? What does Thomas do? And I don't know if there was any informed consent or any full disclosure to the other household members, you know, pets and people. But the guy, right? Did I get this right, Brian? He smeared a whole bunch of bacteria on his face to find out if he would get acne or not, right?
I guess so. He didn't worry about his own consent, I guess.
Well, you got to remember that I had done a few years of research by that time, you know, so I'd been doing 4 years worth of research before I actually took the plunge. So it's not like I did it blindly. I don't think I'd be the first scientist that did that.
Not at all. I won't admit to some of the things I've done.
Yeah.
Some of the things I put in my mouth. Yeah.
Okay, we'll leave that alone. Yeah. All right. So, the pre-pro and postbiotics, actually, we do have whole short episodes on that for beating the bacteria. So check that out if you want a little more of a discussion there. But, really briefly, a probiotic is what we're talking about. Probiotic skincare and biome care is what we're talking about today. And as a brief kind of recap of last week, we were kind of looking at the fact that, you know, somebody had written an article and then several people after that about probiotic skincare being a lie. And we're trying to dissect that and see if that's actually a fact or fiction. And what we came up with was that it depends on the way that you define probiotic. And so the kind of second statement was that any probiotic is a probiotic regardless of where it's used. And we found that that was false. that you know, how you define probiotic is a legitimate concern. It matters. Definitions matter here, and we found that there's basically a the heart of what a probiotic should be is that it needs to engraft into the area in which it's supposed to be used so that it can actually give a benefit to the body. And so that something that works for the gut may not work for the skin and vice versa, because it won't be able to survive and engraft there given the niche. And then we went on to talk about and where we are now, which is that microbiome diversity means skin health. And we found that that's not always true, especially on the skin, because on the skin we found that it's actually less diversity that seems to be, at least in certain areas of the body, including the face, that tend to be more associated with health. And that now we're talking about C. acnes or Cutibacterium acnes, which is the bacteria that for decades people have thought is the cause of acne, or at least a cause of acne. And we're now discussing the fact that we actually see more C. acnes when you have healthy skin and less C. acnes and more of other things that are thought to be healthy or commensal or benign skin bacteria or neutral skin bacteria, like Staphylococcus epidermidis, on lesional skin versus non-lesional skin. And so that's where we left it off. And so we were talking about a case study where somebody that had atopic on their face and or dermatitis on their face, I'm sorry, and they had less diversity and more C. acnes on the non-lesional skin, meaning what we think about as always being true when we talk about skin health with inflammatory skin issues is turning out not to really be all that true, at least not always. And there's actually more and more evidence showing that these things are not true. And then what I did was I actually looked at my own skin. We did the same experiment in my skin, which we called a desquame. And it's just sticker we talked about that you just rip it off and it takes all the stuff off your skin and from the follicles. And you can test that through genetic sequencing. And we actually found that I had even lower, and I don't have dermatitis, never have, never had psoriasis. I had acne as a kid. Interestingly, the last time I tested my skin, which was back in 2017 when I first started using the C. acnes on my skin, I had MRSA still on my skin. Because I was hospitalized back in 2008, I believe, when I was in postdoc.
And MRSA would be a resistant Staph aureus, which normally grows in the back of the throat, sometimes can cause strep throat.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so it's also Staph aureus is a strain that's typically associated with atopic dermatitis mm-hmm. on the skin as well. And we won't get into all that, but it also causes biofilm formation and things of that nature. Interestingly, when they... You can see here from the report that you guys who are listening or watching can't see, but I actually had 0% Staph aureus on my skin. Typically, people have some, a little bit, maybe up to 1%. At least that's what the most reports are saying. And the Staph epidermidis, which people are saying is commensal, and you know they're saying that normative is between 20 and 30%. I had 0.38%, so less than 0.5%. And then C. acnes, I had 90% in this particular testing area. And so, you know, I'm sure that if we did it from day to day, it might vary slightly depending on, you know, but you got to remember, I have been putting on copious amounts of specific strains of C. acnes for years now. And so, you know, you can judge for yourself whether or not I have, you know, inflammatory skin issues, but I don't think I do.
Looks pretty good from here.
Thank you. And so it's one of those things where that is one of the reasons why I did it back in the day to test it on myself to see kind of over the years how things progressed and whether or not, you know, I could myself stand behind this type of strategy. And I was actually taken aback when I saw these results. And now I think we did it twice. And the other time it wasn't as dramatic, but it was similar. Where I didn't have any Staph aureus, I didn't have any, and interestingly, they looked at Lactobacillus acidophilus, and I didn't have any of that either. And typically they're saying that you should have up to 1%, is that right? Yep, 1% there, and somewhere between 0.5% to 1%. I don't know if I agree. I think that Lactobacillus may be more transient in nature than engraft, because you're gonna have it in certain areas of your body that you might touch and then, you know, spread it around. But the real question is it really relevant in a significant way to where I need to use it as a probiotic? And that's where, you know, what we're talking about. Is it legitimately going to be, which of these would be legitimate probiotic based on the data that we're looking at? You know, would it be Staph aureus? Probably not. I mean, we may someday find out. I mean, there are strains that if you test non-lesional skin of Staph aureus, that if you put it onto a mouse, it won't cause inflammation. And then if you take the lesional skin and take the Staph aureus there, it will cause inflammation on a mouse. So we know that there are different strains of Staph aureus, just like there's different strains of C. acnes and Lactobacillus acidophilus and Staph epidermidis. So it may be someday we find out that there maybe are beneficial Staph aureus. But right now, all we know is that it's blamed for a lot of things like atopic dermatitis, MRSA, you know, staph infections. What do you think, Brian?
No, I totally agree. So again, we're finding out more and more things as we go along. I mean, if you think about, you know, 15, 20 years ago, we had virtually no idea what was actually on the skin, or very limited as towards what we were able to grow on the skin and be able to characterize it.
So, right, because most of it's not culturable.
Yeah.
And you know, in the previous cast last week, we used a word at least three times, I think, nuance, one of my favorite words, and there's nuance in this. Can you tell me how do you guys look at the different strains? What testing assay is done to say that not every bacteria that's a certain species is like the other one?
Yes. So typically what we use is a metagenomic. So let me say that in a simpler way. So there's specific genes. Okay. You can't hear us? Okay. So there are specific genes that bacteria have, and it's specific to bacteria. And so these are ribosomal. So it's an organelle, I guess you could say, of a bacteria that helps to translate genetic material into proteins. And the specific part of, and again, everybody, I'm going to promote Beauty and the Bacteria because there's a whole episode that talks about this. But there's a specific part of this ribosome, this little organelle, that is called the 16S. It's a subunit. And the RNA that makes that up actually has a unique property, so that there's a certain part that doesn't change. Doesn't matter which bacteria that you look at, it's the same. But then there's a certain part they call a variable region, that if you look at the different strains or species of bacteria, you can actually tell based on the sequence what species it is and actually what strain it is based on the different sequences. So there's little point mutations that are different between them. And so we actually use that to take a sample, and we can tell all the different types of bacteria that are in any given sample. And it's pretty specific.
Yeah, since one of my sons may be listening to this, and he's a little simple-minded, I won't admit which one he is, but what you just said was that in the cell you have this little manufacturing facility that makes the proteins.
Right.
And so instead of looking at the genes or growing up in culture, you can look at these little manufacturing facilities that have different signposts in front of them. And so you can kind of tell, it's like a marker.
Yes, but it's actually the genes that code for that.
Okay, the genes that you look at. Code for the manufacturing facility. Okay.
So interestingly, those are made up of RNA as well as protein. So the ribosomes are actually made legitimately of nucleic acid as well as proteins. And it's the part that is made of nucleic acid that the gene that encodes that RNA is what you look at.
Andrew will understand that.
Okay. Oh. Oops. All right, somebody's not getting a Father's Day gift next year.
He's got a year to go before.
Yeah, he'll forget about it. Regardless, that's what we would look at in order to test any given sample. To Brian's point, back in the day, we would just culture them. And even today, they'll culture things to do micro or whatnot. But I think they say like 90%+, I think it's like 99% of the bacteria are not culturable. And so the only way that we can see them is by, you know, by doing this. And well, I'm sure there's probably other ways too, I just don't know about, but you know, you just can't culture them. And so, back, you know, for instance, like gram positive and gram negative, which again, on the series we talk about, that was a traditional way of knowing, you know, also which types of bacteria by looking whether they stain certain ways or not, what the way they look like under a microscope, what they look like as they grow on a plate, which plates they grow on, what nutrients they use to grow, which is all a clue as to why certain bacteria are going to colonize certain areas and not others, because they'll have certain nutrients in certain parts of your body. You produce sebum on your skin. You don't produce it in your gut. You produce sweat on your skin, not in your gut. And so these are the types of things that certain bacteria will eat, but you know, it wouldn't necessarily survive in the gut or vice versa. So depending on what food's available, what temperature it is, what pH it is, all these things are gonna, you know, are gonna tell us whether or not a bacteria can live in a certain place. And that's why sometimes they will engraft, sometimes they won't. And I believe that a lot of what we call planktonic, or just kind of free floating bacteria on the skin, gets measured because of transference. Like we're touching different body parts, or we're touching a dog, or we're touching food, and we can sample that with a swab, and then we're gonna say, oh, you have this bacteria on your skin, when in essence that was just a transference.
It's the reason in surgery we don't just, somebody's got a possible infection, we just don't like to go swab it, because it's going to give you information that may not help the situation.
Right.
So, exact same thing.
Yeah, you got to go a little deeper if you really want to get the information, to a whole more holistic information. And that's the problem with a lot of microbiome science, even currently, even though we're light years from where we were, there's still debate as to how the best sampling is to be taken. And there's still, you can even see, like there's a couple of brands that use swabs, and then they give them to customers and say, you know, now we can tell you all this stuff about your skin. Where in essence, I say that's kind of a little bit of hogwash, because we're not getting deep enough to truly know what the skin microbiome is. You have to go deeper. You have to do use something like a D-squame. And even then, it can be a little technique dependent.
Right.
Yeah.
And again, as, sort of, as you mentioned, the depth as you go down, it sort of, is it two tape strippings, or is it six tape strippings? Or
right, because if you have thicker skin.
The glossy layer between the epidermis and the dermis, you know, where do you stop?
Right, right. And if I have, if I'm a young male and I have 2 millimeter thick skin versus a 70-year-old female who has a 0.5 millimeter skin, am I going to capture the same, using the same technique, am I going to capture the same amount of information? Does it matter?
I love being in a room with a whole bunch of nuance-infused people.
You just called us eggheads.
You guys too. Nuance-infused.
But yeah, regardless, if we go back to the idea of, does more diversity equal better on the skin? The answer is no, not always. It may in some instances. I mean, the literature does typically say that that on lesional atopic dermatitis, there's less diversity versus non-lesional skin. But I do think that there is some disagreement, because even in our case study, we did not see that. We saw the opposite. And I believe there is some literature that bucks against that. I think possibly there's some bias because of the acceptance that more diversity equals healthy. And I think that people are trying to, you know, make their data fit the model sometimes. For an example of this is there was a publication about C. acnes that they actually, they took the membrane. So they cracked it open, took everything out, and they just, and so what we know is that the membranes of bacteria are inherently inflammatory because the body's the immune system's primed against that. Now, if they're intact, it's not necessarily inflammatory, but they took the C. acnes, they took the membrane fraction, and they put it against, was it keratinocytes, or was it equivalents of skin or something like that?
I think it was skin equivalent.
Yeah, it was a skin equivalent, so like a tissue-engineered skin. So basically, to everybody, they can actually put layers of cells like skin. It's not actually human skin, but it's made from human skin cells, and they assume that it acts similarly to how skin might react to certain.
But it's more ethical to do it that way.
Yeah, unless you get it from like
an accepting host.
The host
accepts it a lot better.
Yeah, I mean, you don't have secondary structures like you do on skin. You don't have the immune cells typically. You don't have the pilosebaceous units. But it gives you an idea of how in the present, because if you take a simple culture of keratinocytes, which is the outermost layer of skin cells, versus fibroblasts, which is the dermis, which is below the, you know, you get different than if you have them together growing. So they wanted to look at kind of a more closely related to actual skin. So they tested this and they found that it upregulates in the fibroblasts, I believe, it upregulates, no, it's in the keratinocytes, it upregulated things like Ki-67, I believe, and filaggrin, which filaggrin's a gene that is typically a problem for those who have atopic dermatitis. It's something that helps the barrier, like the ceramides and this, all that stuff that you hear about in skincare.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's all that makes the barrier tight, nice, so that things don't get in and cause issues. You have problems with that typically when you have atopic. Not everybody has genetic issues with filaggrin, but it's common. And so when I was reading that, I'm thinking, so you're telling me that C. acnes actually induces a better barrier. But the way that they interpret it was, because it's inducing it too high, it's going to cause comedones because it's going to over-keratinize the skin.
And that was also the Ki-67, which is talking about proliferation.
Yeah, which is cell proliferation, which when I read that, that's not the way I interpreted it. First, I said you used an artificial form because there's not a lot of times going to be a bunch of husks of C. acnes on skin. It'll be the actual C. acnes bacterium. And everybody needs to remember that bacteria doesn't typically die. It typically just divides and divides and divides and divides unless you kill it or another bacteria or something kills it. So that's pretty artificial as a test. But what I read into that was that if C. acnes is in its normative state and not like a concentrated state or a artificial state, it's upregulating cell proliferation and barrier repair. Cell proliferation is something that we pay good money for with retinoids. You know?
What is C. acnes?
C. acnes? It's... I'm sorry. Do you... After 10 episodes.
Yeah, right.
I'm asking for everybody.
Okay, so because we're starting this over again from the last episode, C. acnes is a bacteria that's on the skin that is typically being blamed for acne. And so what we're talking about is that C. acnes is a species of bacteria, and we don't believe necessarily that it is the cause for acne. And we're going to get into some more data in a second that actually shows that. But we do know that it is on everybody's skin. It is ubiquitous and in pretty high amounts. In your hair follicles, it's upwards of 89% on average. And so on my skin, it was about 90%, which is, but that's all of my skin. That wasn't just my follicle. So when you take the whole skin, like the surface as well, it's typically probably more likely in the 60% to 80% range.
That's our understanding. Yeah.
Yeah, and even in the samples that we were looking at, it was around that.
Except for you.
Except for me, and even on the non-lesional sample from the other dermatitis patient.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's what C. acnes is. Thank you, Alan, for asking the.
And that's also the thing that you put on your face.
It is. It's yes, all. Yes. But we'll get into that in a second too, but. Where was I going before?
We were talking about the fragments and
what they
induced.
Yeah, and so basically that experiment is an example of the fact that there's misinterpretation of some scientific research that's being done simply because there's a presupposition.
Mm-hmm,
you're assuming that it's already causing disease, so you're going to interpret your data in a certain way. Now, what we could say is that I also wanted to kind of look at this as well in order to kind of say, well, I don't believe that that's the way you should interpret that data. So I've actually looked at the strains that we study in our lab, and I've asked our scientists to look at things like collagen induction and Ki-67 induction and IGF-1 induction. So there was also a paper recently that looked at retinoids with IGF-1 and showed basically that the reason why collagen is induced in UV when UV hits the skin is through the IGF-1 when you use retinoids in response to UV damage. It actually upregulates collagen through IGF-1, which is a cytokine that's basically associated with cell growth and proliferation. Mm-hmm. I believe it's insulin growth factor 1. Yeah. And those names are because scientists find them in certain ways. It doesn't mean they're not associated with other
things. They named them a long time ago.
Yeah,
because
they discover them in a certain way.
Right.
An example of that is C. acnes, right? Because they thought it caused acne, they called the species acnes.
That's right.
And so we're now talking about how that might need to change. We also tested, and we saw that C. and it's also been published that C. acnes does upregulate IGF-1 as well. And we showed that it upregulates IGF-1. And we show it upregulates collagen 1 and collagen 3. And so these are things that when you look at the evidence, you say, well, that's what people propose that things like vitamin C do and retinoic acid does. And you're telling me that I already not only have some of that on my skin already, but I try to get rid of it. Like I actively seek out to destroy it. And so does a lot of my doctors. And so that's really where the problem is that when we think of skincare, that's the baggage it carries with it. Because skincare, in the philosophy of traditional skincare, it's kill bacteria. You know, there was a trend of antibacterial. Even now, you'll look at certain ingredients and they'll say it's an antibacterial ingredient. So that word also is something that people have latched on to as better. Antibacterial is better. We're saying that no, it's not. But there's also a nuance to that, since you like nuances, is that antibacterial is actually something that bacteria themselves produce. They call them antimicrobial peptides. And so, in essence, it's almost like a antibiotic. But bacteria produce their own types of antibiotics that are specific against what they see as an enemy. And so, for instance, C. acnes, as a species, at least produces two types of bacteriocins, which is an antimicrobial peptide, maybe more. We think we've discovered another one in this in the strain that we're looking at that is specific against Staphylococcus, which is something like MRSA that we talked about. So very interestingly, we think that's one of the reasons why the C. acnes rules the follicle, because it's able to keep the other bacteria out and in their place. And likewise, Staphylococcus also produces AMPs, or antimicrobial peptides, against C. acnes. And so they kind of they establish their own niches based on the substances they produce. And I think that's why when we see certain strains that don't produce certain AMPs and such, it gets out of whack. And that interaction that's out of whack is what actually leads to more inflammatory diseases. So that, again, is a whole diatribe about why diversity is not always better. It's not about diversity, it's about balance. It's the innate balance of the microbiome and whether the strains and the environment can produce that balance.
And am I right that interleukin 31 is also antibacterial?
I'm not sure.
Brian, check me on that, okay?
Yeah, I'll check on that.
The next podcast, y'all just jump in and say, by the way, Lawrence was right about the interleukin 31. Could be 37, but it wasn't 32. That's Baskin-Robbins.
It might cause the immune system to attack bacteria. Right,
there's immune response certainly in there, but I guess I was trying to think truly antibacterial.
But this idea that these bacteria actually produce their own antibacterials is the reason we need to stimulate some bacteria.
Right.
Nuance.
And you're right. And I think part of that is, we'll talk about, the different strains, because we did allude to it the last episode about different strains having such genetic differences that we actually classify subspecies very, they're so genetically different that you can actually maybe even someday
tease them
apart.
Name, yeah.
Or sure. A new species name. Yeah.
Species name. Yeah.
And so one of the things is I have a graph up here that basically speaks to there is research, and we've shown this as well, that certain strains of bacteria can cause the immune cells in our bodies to act differently, to secrete different cytokines to either be pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory. Now, this is not just an issue with inflammatory skin diseases. This also feeds into aging, because you have to remember that one of the main reasons we age is because we start to collect what's called senescent cells. Brian, what is a senescent cell? In a lay term, maybe I should ask.
Go ahead,
Alan or Jose. Or do you guys remember what a senescent cell is?
No, I have no clue.
All right.
Medical school is a long time ago for me, but I think a senescent cell. You know, we got this idea of programmed cell death,
right?
And it's not just that the cells seem to be sort of programmed to die, but them sticking around in the process of dying, they kind of drag others down with them, right?
Right.
So you go through senescence where you got these systems that don't just, they're not neutral. They're actually going in the wrong direction.
Right. They're like a drunk friend that doesn't want to leave the party, right?
Yeah, right.
You know, it's you liked him once, but now you're not so sure anymore.
Yeah, right.
They're just irritating everybody. And similarly, a senescent cell, really, that's what it does. It just irritates everything else, and it can actually drag other cells down with it because it produces certain substances that are inflammatory and also can cause senescence of other cells. And we have immune cells in our body that actually act to get rid of those. But we also have immune cells that tell the body, don't get rid of certain things. And that's where the problem starts to become a little hairy, because there's senescent cell accumulation, but part of it's because we have these Treg cells in our immune system that start to say, oh, they're okay. You know, it's like the enabler friend that lets the drunk friend stay, even though it's time they should have gone.
I'm understanding.
Yeah.
This is so good.
And so the Treg cells, you know, basically you wonder whether, where does it start? Where's that loop start? And can we get rid of that loop or stop that cycle? And part of it has to do with possibly the instigation of inflammation. So we know that chronic inflammation is associated heavily with cancers. And part of that's because also the immune cells in the body, after they're constantly inundated with signals for inflammation, they start to become accustomed to it and change the way they react to inflammation. And that is a problem. And so then you start to miss things that you shouldn't otherwise miss as far as like some cancer cells. And I think the same is true because there's a lot of similarities with senescent cells and cancer cells as far as why they are the way they are, the way that the immune system interacts with them, and their association with inflammation. And so when we think about the microbiome and how it can actually influence the immune system's regulation, you have to wonder what is the implications into a healthy microbiome for aging as well as disease.
Now, is there senescence for mammalian cells? Now, is there senescence for bacterial cells?
Oh, wow, you threw a curveball at me.
Sorry, that's a good curveball right there. Yeah.
So that I don't know, because typically bacterial cells just divide, but there is a certain state in which they actually stop dividing because there's nutrient deficiency. So...
Is this something to do with dog ears? And
well, you know, that's a great question. Because actually one of the things that we ran up against is because in the strain that we deal with, we actually inserted a genetic switch into it so that we could actually turn off its default state is don't grow, just function, just metabolize. And so we have plenty of evidence that shows that it will metabolize and function properly other than growing and dividing, because that also takes energy to grow and divide. So and then you add a certain sugar, and that sugar will actually allow it to start growing. And so what we were asked by a lot of people was, well, how long can it stay like that? Because how long is the life cycle of a bacteria that doesn't divide? And nobody's really asked that question, because bacteria don't have a life cycle that they don't divide, really. You know, I guess eventually if they run out of nutrients, they'll just die. But, you know.
Typically, they go into that stasis, which can last for years.
Right, right. Yeah.
So, and, you know, they found bacteria that's in stasis that, you know, on cadavers and everything else that have been back in the, you know, thousands of years.
Oh, I did not know that.
You just got Elon Musk attention. You just did. Stasis.
You're saying that?
Stasis.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's a super interesting thing, because what we found was that if you turn that gene off that allows it to divide, it's a certain operon or a certain group of genes, it actually only lasts about 45 days after that, and then it just craps out. So the stasis thing is because maybe there's some mechanism in which it slowly divides, and that's how it stays in stasis. I don't know, but I don't really know the answer to what the nuance there is. But we do know that you know, the ability of these certain microbes to influence the immune system, whether it's in stasis or not, it's there, and it's important. And so, really, let's get back to our discussion here about. We were talking about the diversity. I think we beat that topic, though. Mm-hmm. I think we've agreed that diversity is not always better, although depending on the area, sometimes diversity is healthier. Now, the next question is, well, or the next statement is, if we have an idea of what a legitimate skin probiotic should be, and we know the area that we want to apply this probiotic to, that being the skin, what about the fact that you want something like I'm holding a little container that we typically see skincare in. If I want to put microbes, live microbes in here, can you formulate something with live microbes? And most people would say, and I've heard this said by not lay people, but dermatologists even in when they're interviewed, is that you cannot formulate with live microbes because there's preservatives in skincare. And also, you know, how would you keep them alive on a shelf for any length of time? And so then that's, you know, feeds back into the skin probiotics being a lie, or a probiotic skincare being a lie, because they're now hearing, well, it's impossible to formulate with live microbes. That's why we use postbiotics, and we call it probiotics, but it's postbiotics. And that is a statement that I believe is fiction. And I'll tell you why, because there actually are things on the market currently. And there's about to be something on the market that actually are legitimate live microbes that are formulated. Now, you can debate whether they're probiotics, but they're live microbes. And so an example of this is I'm not going to use brand names because I don't want to anger anybody or have any litigious people come after me. But there's a live microbe that's in a culture that you refrigerate. And so basically it's just a culture that you take out of the refrigerator and you spray.
I didn't understand that.
Oh.
Your Siri decided to...
Let's just say my watch said that.
So my phone is talking to me. So I think it heard something else. But it's a culture of microbes, and it's not skin related, meaning it's not found on the skin. But basically, so we could debate whether it's a legitimate probiotic. But regardless, it grows. It's a bacteria. It stays in the refrigerator. You take it out and you spray yourself, and it can put on your skin some bacteria for whatever purposes. There's also another that actually is shelf stable. That's from Europe, and they actually are in these little tapioca beads, and inside is a oil only, and so there's no water. And so they basically put these in hibernation, and then you break them open, and it's lactobacillus. So again, I don't particularly think the lactobacillus is going to engraft. They claim it's used for acne, but again, it's debatable whether that's considered a probiotic. They do call it that. And then the last kind of one that I know as an example of it is one that we've actually worked on at Crown, which is a version of live C. acnes. XYCM42 is the strain. And this is one what we've been studying for a better part of a decade, and it has the genetic switch in it and such. And this one is shelf stable. We stopped measuring it at about 10 months, and we were still seeing a copious amount of viable product. Now, that being said, there is some degradation over time, but the real question is, in a microbe that's going to divide and such, how many is necessary to have an effectiveness or an efficacy on the skin as a probiotic? And Brian, just a real like low level overview, what's the answer for that?
We see that the numbers, at least based after what you've seen in sort of stability, is still quite functional in regarding seeing benefits in the skin.
Right. And so, I think, we talked about how a lot of times we'll just take our skincare companies will just take ingredients and use the claims from those ingredients. And one of the things that we have, I think, gone above and beyond with, especially with the products we're going to talk about today, or at least the ideas, the technology we're talking about today, is that we've done more testing than I think pretty much any other skincare, or even though we call this Biomecare, as this is called Biomecare, but really, and again, I'm trying because I'm really biased here, because so I'm trying to like say things in a way that are explanatory and even to those who may see the bias there, because we've taken so much time to do this. So I don't know how that's coming across to you as somebody who would actually purchase these things for your end consumer or your patients.
Well, I think it would come across very positively to anybody who's sort of scientifically based. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's become more and more an accepted fact that the gut microbiome is huge. I mean, even traditional surgeons are starting to pre-treat their patients to make sure that before a patient goes into an elective surgery, that microbiome is more beneficial. We do it in breast surgery. Dentists do it. Mm-hmm. You're really concerned that when you have a dental procedure, it's considered a dirty area of the body. And so that when they instrument it, we know that it seeds the body with bacteria. Well, those bacteria need to be met with an equal force of good bacteria, right? So, the fact that you've made these comments that on their face are true, mm-hmm. clearly that it's going to be a whole different ball game on the skin, and you've been thinking about it these years, and you're bringing this evidence to the fore. I think it's going to be very receptive. I think a lot of people who like to think in this space, who like nuance, are going to readily accept the possibility that you're completely right.
Right, and I felt very strongly even before. I joined Crown that my research would require a physician base to adopt it before the consumer base would adopt it, because I think that it's a large hurdle for a consumer to get past the fact that I've just been told for my whole life that this is something I should avoid, and now you're telling me not to. It's confusing. I don't know if I can trust that, where I think a physician's able to discern whether or not something is accurate and viable. And then once the physician starts to tell the consumer base, then the consumer base, you know, feels that they can trust that.
Dr. Brian, why have neither of us used the word paradigm shift? Yeah. I have no idea.
I should have thought about that.
Yeah.
It absolutely is. I mean, when you think about it, I mean, it's a, I don't know, you can call it a double paradigm shift because, again, now we're introducing product with bacteria in the product. And then we're also trying, the bacteria itself is associated negatively is towards skin, but yet we see very positive results. We see benefits that are clearly are based on the bacteria itself and what the bacteria does within the formulations.
Yeah, I think we should start a hashtag justice for C. acnes.
Yes. <There we go>. Yeah, absolutely.
So on that vein here, this next statement, number five, is that Cutibacterium acnes or C. acnes causes acne. And we've already talked a little bit about this, that we don't believe that's necessarily the cause. So we think this is fiction, but I think it's also fact. I think that, again, and it's going to get to the next statement, that it's, you know, basically, if you look at it as a species, it's too difficult to answer this question. You have to look at it as the fact that it's actually made of several subspecies. And if you look at it, the fact that the subspecies are so divergent, you know, like a wolf versus a beagle being in the same species, you know, that's when you start to understand, okay, now I see that maybe it was true in one sense and false in one sense. And so we looked at some evidence that, you know, basically we all have this species of bacteria on our skin. Everybody in the world, from birth to death, sometimes more, sometimes less, and depending on the state of your skin as well. But we've actually done research at Crown and before my research even before Crown that showed that specific strains not only were not inflammatory, but actually reduced inflammation. Meaning if the skin was already inflamed, or we actually did this in skin cell types, skin explants. So when people had facelifts, we would collect that tissue and actually try that. We in skin equivalents, which is what we talked about earlier, which is fake or artificially made skin, which has skin cells. I guess I shouldn't say it's artificial skin, but it's engineered, tissue engineered skin.
Tissue engineered.
Yeah, it doesn't have the secondary structures, but... and so in all of them, we saw a similar trend, which was this specific strain from this from the species of C. acnes defendens, which is the phylotype, actually reduced inflammation. Not only that, we saw that if we took immune cells from acneic skin or people that had acne, and we took immune cells, we call them PBMCs, they're from blood, so you take the immune cells from the blood, and we took them from healthy individuals and from acne individuals. We found that with both, if you applied the strain of bacteria, it reduced inflammation significantly. Now, interestingly, with the acneic skin, it didn't reduce it as much. Now, that being said, it was still significant, but it was not as much because, again, it's not just a microbial issue. It's also a genetic issue. And we know that... people that are predisposed to acne, also there's been evidence to show that their immune cells are not able to balance out their cell signaling as much. And so they tend to put out more inflammatory signals than anti-inflammatory signals. Now, that being said, we also know that the right type of C. acnes has been shown to help to modulate that. So it's really, we're not there yet, but we're starting to see that there's possibility that we could actually even treat acneic skin with bacteria like C. acnes that was considered the culprit, and that it may be actually deleterious to try to rid the body of C. acnes when it actually is protecting against things like biofilms from Staph aureus and Staph epidermidis that have been shown to ingress into the follicle when you see acne. So the real question is, what's causative, what's correlative? Like, what causes the acne and what's just associated with acne? And interestingly, we did one of our podcasts on acne with Jim Layden, who's like the grandfather of dermatology almost, and he basically said that back in the day, he was one of the first to explain that back what was called Cornobacterium acnes, or now then Propionibacterium acnes.
At that time, yeah.
Yeah, and so he explained that he was the person that said it's in the skin. He never claimed that it caused acne. He just said it happens to live there, so you find it with acneic lesions, and that's the part that got lost in translation, and all of a sudden, 50 plus years later, maybe 60 years later, where
it's been 60s when he was starting that work. Yeah.
Yeah. So now we're coming full circle, and he did that. He even had that concept before there was all the genetic sequencing and such. And now we're finding out that he was correct, that it was just a, it just was hanging out there. And now, of course, it may be that some strains do contribute more than others, and we'll see that in a second. But one of the things that I should mention, and we'll get into that in a second, but we also have noted, we do know that we talked about this on the last episode, that the ferment or the product, the molecules that are produced by C. acnes, namely propionic acid, has been shown to reduce the biofilm formation by Staphylococcus species. Mm-hmm. It's also anti-staph, meaning it has antimicrobial peptides that we just talked about against staph, and so it reduces the amount of staph. It produces almost as much antioxidants as you would get like from a vitamin C serum. And these are not, these are antioxidants that have been vetted and published in the literature, and we've actually identified one that we think is novel from these specific C. acnes strains. And then we talked about that. I mean, so basically it's ticking all the boxes here. So all the things that we talked about a legitimate skin probiotic should be, it kind of ticks all those boxes. And so my question, especially to, you know, because we just started having this conversation today or a month ago.
Right, right. Yeah.
And so, you know, how you've mentioned a couple of times that you're kind of, it's impressed you as far as, you know, we've been kind of fed a, you know, this woman is saying probiotic skincare is a lie. Now we're asking ourselves the question, has our concept of what probiotic skin we call it symbiotic skin was that a lie?
Right.
You know?
Yeah, the clarification that maybe technically you can give is you've actually administered the bacteria that some say causes bacteria to your face, and it didn't.
Yeah.
The technology that the company is supporting right now.
Right, acne. So essentially we've introduced the bacteria that has been associated with causing acne, but
it hasn't caused
it.
But
it hasn't. So that causes us to question that long-held idea that you think maybe we shouldn't have held to be true.
Right.
And the technology that we're talking about is a different population of biological population.
Right, right. It's a specific subspecies. So, you know, where if you think of the wolf beagle analogy, you know, it's probably going to be a beagle because, I mean, it depends on how you look at it, right?
The wolf and the beagle have the same genetics, but one of them's going to cuddle with you.
Yeah, right. And one will eat you.
Yes.
And so, but it's a similar. They don't have the exact same genetics, but they're enough genetically linked that they're in the same species. But they're genetically diverse or different enough, desperate enough that they are obviously not the same. And so that's where if we think of it that way, it kind of makes us think, okay, maybe there is something we missed, which is we threw out the baby with the bathwater. You know, we got a taste of what this particular strain can do in a bad way, but we didn't consider maybe there was a flip side to the coin.
Well, you brought up earlier, again, whether it be a month ago or earlier today, was the fact that, again, as far as looking at epidermidis estoris in the follicle and the fight that occurs between the two,
right,
and trying to compete between that, is that it causing an inflammatory response?
Right.
And is that leading towards causing inflammatory lesions and acne?
Right.
So is it a case of, you know, do we have good, do we have a wolf bacteria or wolf C. acnes that's overproducing or overreacting? Or maybe it's actually a case that having that over-expression is actually good because it keeps the other bacteria out of the follicle and doesn't cause the lesion to form. So there's a lot of different ways to be looking at this.
Right, and we also can't assume that there's a pure, that it's homogenous as far as the number of subspecies. So you could have multiple strains of C. acnes in the follicle and multiple strains of Staphylococcus epidermidis on the skin. And so it complicates things because you can't just say you have all wolves or you have all beagles. There could be wolves and beagles together, you know, and maybe the wolves piss off the beagles or vice versa. And this is kind of breaking down a little bit, but, you know, it's one of those things where that's where it's not as cut and dry. And that's where people kind of don't want to, they kind of get lost because they say, I thought I knew the story. And it sounds like the story is a little bit more complicated than we once thought. But that's kind of medicine and biology to me, is that
It is. It is. While you guys were talking, I actually pulled out my Merriam-Webster dictionary, and I realized that disparate and desperate are two different words. So, yeah, if anybody like me got a little confused, I'm now on track.
Yeah, sometimes when I say that word, I actually wonder, did I pronounce it correctly?
You did. So, no, okay. You pronounced it right. I'm glad I brought that with me.
Yeah. So, I mean, again, so when we go back to our whole last episode when we talked about those kind of five facets of what legitimately would constitute a probiotic, and the stuff that we've talked about with C. acnes on the skin throughout these two episodes, basically all those boxes are checked. And of course, it's going to become, which is our next topic, our next statement here, is that the benefits of probiotic are species specific, which is actually it's a trick statement because it's fiction. It's not species specific. It's strain specific. And that's where a lot of people get tripped up. And to the chagrin of a lot of supplement companies that, you know, again, don't want to necessarily do all the research. They just want to throw the ingredients in. Because even with probiotics for the gut, you cannot look at a label and see Lactobacillus acidophilus and assume that the product that you've been taking that's more expensive that works is the same as the one that's half as expensive and may not work. It may work still, but because they could always just culture the one that works. But, you know, because you really can't patent a given species of natural microbe, at least not nowadays. You used to be able to.
Not anymore.
Yeah, about 10 years ago, I think they changed the patent laws. But, you know, it's very strain specific. And this is something that is seen by the World Health Organization as well as, you know, many scientists. And you'll find that anybody that's legitimately in the probiotic space as far as from a medicine or scientific perspective will tell you that. Now, one of the things from the C. acnes perspective, as we've been alluding to, is that there's quite a few strains. And what we do know through research by Fitzgibbons, I think that's Dr. Lee's lab as well, in 2013, they took the top 10 number of groupings, which we call ribotypes, which is, we talked about the 16S ribotypes. The top 10 of them, which there's many different strains in each ribotype, but the ribotype number 6 is the one that has almost no association with acne. So when they looked in acneic people and they looked in people that had healthy skin, 1% of them had acne that had this ribotype, and 99% of the healthy people had this ribotype. And if you look at, for instance, others like RT8, ribotype 8, 100% of acneic people had that on their skin, and 0% came from people that were healthy. So that means that, yes, there are indeed strong associations of certain strains with disease and strong associations with health. But like we were just saying, you cannot throw the baby out with the bathwater and say, then I need to get rid of all C. acnes, because mm-hmm. we've just talked about all the benefits.
Don't throw the poodle out with the Doberman.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I guess that's true. Although for the Doberman lovers, I apologize.
Yes. Yes. yes.
No. Actually, funny story is I have a beagle. That's why I keep saying beagle. Beagles are, in my opinion, the best dogs. That's not debatable. And so I was walking my beagle down the street, and we came across this woman with a puppy, Great Dane. But as a puppy, it was bigger than me, basically. But that puppy wanted to play with my beagle, and my beagle, who was a puppy, wanted to play with the Great Dane. But then the Great Dane thought I was, as the beagle was looking to say hello, the Great Dane thought it'd be funny to put its mouth over my beagle's head. And I about had a heart attack. And the look on my beagle's face, its eyes got all wide, and it just kind of sat there.
You said, am I a good parent right now?
Yeah, I was like, I probably shouldn't let him. So we went our merry way. Luckily, he didn't chomp down, because I think he probably could have easily destroyed my beagle. But again, all right, we're almost done. All right. So Alan's, he's pushing us to wrap this up, but we're almost there. You know, really, again, there's one other consideration you mentioned about getting body, would you say, before surgery, you want to get the body kind of prepped with the microbiome. And part of that's also diet, right? Because, you know, you can eat certain things that cause disruption of the GI tract. And a lot of people don't realize that some of that's because of what happens when you put that food with the microbes that live in your gut. They can actually create gases, or they can create things that are irritating based on the food source that you have. And we know that Western diets versus Eastern diets can actually, and that means not the United States, but the world, like the Asian countries versus the United States, we know that the Western diets are associated with inflammatory issues because of the foods we refine sugars and starches, where other places in the world they don't. And that's where the raw food diets and stuff have come into vogue. But we know that with C. acne specifically, as we're talking mainly about that, is that C. acne actually produces porphyrins, but the healthy associated strains produce very little. And if you add certain foods, it doesn't really change what they produce. But with the disease associated ones, it really significantly increases porphyrin production, which actually is irritating to the skin and causes free radical damage and such. And so the last kind of statement here is that, you know, we've looked at C. acne, it ticks all the boxes. We've seen that it's kind of a myth that all C. acne are bad. And then essentially we actually know at least one strain that we've studied and multiple strains that we've studied actually are symbiotic to skin and produce great things for the skin. The question is, from a cosmetic perspective, can it do anything other than just make us more healthy? I guess the answer to that is, well, if we have symbiotic skin, it's more healthy, but what else would that manifest as? And what do you think, Greg?
Well, you know, I'm glad you brought that up with the issue of the diet, because, you know, a lot of, I think people listening to this podcast will be thinking, well, I can't wait to get that stuff.
Right.
Right. But there's been a lot of studies in looking at, we were talking about programmed cell death earlier, mm-hmm. like things like intermittent fasting.
Right, right.
So all kinds of things, how you eat, what you eat, whether you get a little bit of sun, all these things are going to affect the microbiome.
Right.
And what you guys are going to put out there is a shortcut. Because no matter what yep. we do, it may or may not work as much as we want. But there is, I want to just be encouraging to folks, there's always something that you can do to encourage your microbiome to be different. And that's why a lot of people hack their own disease, right? They figure out, oh, I cut out dairy or whatever. So all these things affect this microbiome. And I'm just thrilled that you guys are delving into the science of this so that people can take the shortcut,
right?
And especially if they need it, and do the other things too that can help their skin health.
Right, and I don't know if I would say it's a shortcut necessarily. I think it's more of a push in the right direction.
Yes.
But you're right.
Well, it's rocket fuel.
Yeah, you can't just do outside in, right?
Yeah, yeah,
you have to do inside out and outside in. You can't assume, I think what you meant by a shortcut is that you can't just assume by putting a topical on, it's going to fix anything.
Right.
It can help, but it has to be habitual as far as a healthy lifestyle. And that's with anything. Like, you know, if you're going to pay a bunch of money to have a fractional resurfacing and then you still go out in the sun without SPF.
Do the work.
You know, it's like you're changing it for a bit, but then you're going to end up just causing the same issue.
That's right.
And aging again just as bad, quicker. And so really with the products we've produced here, I'm not allowed to discuss the branding yet. There's like an embargo on that, but I will tell you,
everything's about timing, right?
Yeah, it's about timing. But I'll tell you, you know, if you're interested, come to the Crown website, and there's going to be very, very soon a lot of materials that are going to start coming on available. It's going to talk about the actual products and technology that we're going to be launching. But needless to say, we've come to the conclusion that probiotic skincare may have been a lie. And even if you call it, if you're going to say skincare in the traditional sense, I believe, yeah, it probably is a lie. But I would say if you call it probiotic biome care, where you're actually looking at not just caring for the skin, but caring for the microbiome in the sense that you're actually thinking about what makes the skin microbiome, and how do I keep that in balance and in health, and how do I make sure that I'm not putting something on there that's going to exacerbate a condition or to reduce what should or shouldn't be there, or what should be there and add to what shouldn't be there. Then I think that probiotic biome care is not a lie. And what we're going to put out there is actually going to prove that. And we actually have a whole bunch of clinical data that we showed that it doesn't just make you healthier. It actually ticks a lot of cosmesis boxes. We talked about how the fact that it upregulates certain genes like retinoids do. And you're going to, you know, when once we kind of get this out, and maybe at some point, because we're out of time today, but maybe we'll actually do a kind of high science lecture. We do actually, if you go to the Crown website and go to the medical affairs tab, we did a webinar where we went through the science and showed graphs of all this information, not everything we talked about today, but a lot of it. So you can go there if you're interested to see a little more granular information. And we're actually about to publish a paper on all this.
Right.
You'll be able to find that pretty soon. But in essence, I hope it came across that, you know, we feel that you know, biome care is a reality. And it's something that, you know, although we may not have coined that term, we do feel that it's, as a philosophy, relatively new, and people are still kind of bucking against it because there's been so many years of misinformation. And so I don't know. Greg, do you want to kind of wrap up your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I just want to make my plug to the scientific community. And that is, once this becomes well established that these subtypes are important, we need to talk about a C. Hitch.
Ah.
New genus name, C. Hitch. How can we not do that?
Well, okay. I guess I would not be opposed.
The guy's got so much humility here, but yeah, that's what we're going to have to do.
Well, you know, they'll just credit it to Alfred Hitchcock. It's my whole life. When I was in my doctorate, one of my students that I was mentoring, a graduate student I was mentoring, put something that I had told him how to make, which I did not create. He called it the Hitchcock elixir or something like that, because people were stealing his.
Yeah, right,
so they didn't know what it was. And we got in so much trouble because OSHA saw that and they did not like that.
I'm booking my next flight here because I'm going to be part of the, I'm going to be part of the next cast.
All right. All right. And Brian, what about your wrap up thoughts about what we talked about in the last couple episodes?
No, I think it's been very good. I think we need to get more and more of this information out so that people understand. Because again, like you said, you're going against decades and decades worth of misinformation or what was known at that point in time. I mean, it may not have been meant to be wrong, but it seems to be now coming out to be not absolutely correct. And so I think we need to get this out, and I think people will be very surprised.
I agree. All right. Dr. Jose, what do you think?
Do you hear me correctly? Takeaway from this is that I'm learning that C. acnes, not all bad. Some good, and there are actually lots of good. And two, at least when it comes to the face, less bacterial diversity seems to correlate with healthier skin. And when you have more microbial diversity, you tend to have some of those skin issues that people have, such as eczema, psoriasis, or something else like this. But this is an interesting conversation. I think this podcast was much more, a consumer could understand this one.
Oh,
so maybe this one had to be, the first one had to be more science heavy, so this one could be more consumer. You did all this heavy lifting in the first one, so this one we understand more.
So everybody needs to visualize this. This is coming from a beefy Freddie Mercury right here, right?
They can see it. There's a camera there.
Okay, good.
Yeah, so Freddie Mercury is available after to sign autographs. So Alan and Seti, what did you think? What did you guys think?
You know, I knew all that stuff anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, all right. Well,
I can't wait for the product to come out, because this is like a revolution.
Absolutely.
From what I'm hearing and what I'm seeing so far, I think it's gonna turn the whole industry upside down. There's nothing like that out there, and looking forward to really see the actual product and see people using it.
Yeah, translation, please give me free product. just kidding.
At least for all my family, right?
Yeah, right. So thank you, everyone. I appreciate that everybody here, we're trying to bring science of the skin, not just to physicians, not just to scientists, but to the consumer as well. And so we're all learning how to basically speak the same language. And unfortunately, a lot of it's very large words. And we're trying to boil it down so that everybody can grasp this, because we feel it's very important that everybody is able to care for their own biome and understand why they should ask for certain things from their physician. Now, that being said, physicians go to school a very long time, so don't think that you know more than they do just because you Googled something. But this is a nice start for a conversation with your dermatologist or your surgeon regarding what's the best for your biome. And we're hoping that we can get them to kind of see our side of the story as well. And I think that once they see the evidence, they should.
You have billions of bacteria on your face.
And we think that's awesome. So we hope that was very helpful. Thank you to Dr. Laurence, Dr. Jones, Dr. Maldonado. I'm just going to call him Mercury, Mercury.
Yeah,
and then, of course, to the production staff, Seti and Alan. And we do thank Angela McDonald, who is not here to be able to be here today, and we will see her next time. Thank you for your eyes and ears. We hope this was helpful, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye for now.